It's been another record-setting weekend in Chicago. Gary Selzy became the first ever to top 330 miles an hour in a funny car, and he has already backed it up for a new national speed record. But Tony Pedregon could top him if he can back up his number one qualifying run of 471. Hello, everybody. Welcome to Route 66 Raceway. The burnouts are beginning for our first pair of top fuel cars. That is Doug Herbert. Alongside is Scott Wise, and we're glad you're with us. And here is the top fuel ladder presented by Lucas Oil, and we've highlighted the key matchup of this first round, Doug Coletta and Larry Dixon. It'll be the fifth time they have met this year. Coletta has won three of the first four meetings. Take a look at the other side, Scott Coletta, the number two qualifier, and Tony Schumacher in a somewhat unfamiliar spot in the number seven position, heading into today's final eliminations. Weather has been a factor all weekend. We got washed out yesterday in the final session of qualifying. Here's what it looks like right now.
Marty, we're looking at 71 degrees with 80% humidity. The density altitude, or the corrected altitude, is just above 2,500 feet. Track temperature, the key right there, 79 degrees.
And as we go inside towards the cockpit of Doug Herbert, and he'll line up along Scott Wise. You know, Scott has actually won more rounds this year than Doug, but Herbert and the Snap-on Tool teams with Ed the Ace McCullough turning the wrenches, coming to life here in about the last three races. Blower belt came off of Doug Herbert's car, costing him the win, as Scott Wise recovered to take the win light, and we are underway at Route 66 Raceway. Leader in sports presents exclusive coverage of the $50 million NHRA Powerade Drag Racing Series. Today, the chase for the championship continues with final eliminations of the seventh running of the NHRA Route 66 Nationals from Route 66 Raceway in Joliet, Illinois, just southwest of Chicago. Hello again, everybody. Marty Reid, Mike Dunn, and in the pits, we've got Bill Stevens, Dave Reif, and Parker Johnstone. And boy, have we had a tough weekend with the weather. But whenever we've had the weather, and this is the fourth time in eight national events when weather has either postponed or actually washed out a session, and as you well know, in Pomona, we had to come back a week later. But Mike, every time that has happened, we've seen some stellar upsets and some outstanding performances.
Well, you know, the thing, you'd think the teams would have a handle on it by now, as many times we've been rained out the last couple of years, or delayed anyway. But I'll tell you what, I mean, the track conditions are very good here because they redid the surface on the racetrack. They kept the original 500 feet of concrete, and then from 500 feet to just past the finish line, brand new asphalt, and they ground that thing smooth, and that's why we saw the great speed we saw in Funny Car. And I think basically based on that today, we're going to see some more good runs and some great racing.
Well, we hear the 8,000 horsepower engines come to life, and there you see the points leader in top fuel. That is the Sarge, Tony Schumacher, and TJ Zizzo. This is a hometown event for TJ, as he'll be in the right lane. And now that the burnouts have been completed, let's talk a little bit more about the Sarge. Since Alan Johnson came on board, which was at this event 1 year ago, he has been in 21 races as a team together. They've had six number one qualifiers. Of course, he had four before that for a total of 10. But he's been in 10 finals and has won eight of those events.
Well, and let's throw this out, Marty. I mean, they haven't looked real good in qualifying. And that man right there, Alan Johnson, still is not real comfortable with that new Goodyear tire. But remember, the last race, they looked great qualifying and went out first round. So with this team, anything can happen.
Let's go to Bill.
And Mike, that was the point that I was going to make. And just to amplify that a little bit, Tony Schumacher's also a hometown kid. He won this race last year with Alan Johnson. Family and friends are here. He's got to have butterflies in his stomach. Remember, TJ Zizzo went 462 in qualifying. A very strong run. Tony cannot take in lightly.
That was a career best for TJ in that qualifying run. And you're right. I think there are a bit of butterflies in both these guys' stomachs.
Yeah, and TJ Zizzo has looked very good. I mean, they came out of the box, ran a 4.70, and then came back and ran a 4.62. So they've improved on every run. If they can just go up by there and do basically the same thing as that 4.62, maybe improve a little bit, and Tony makes a mistake, they can definitely nail him.
You saw TJ hike the front end, and a good solid run by Tony Schumacher. He stops the clock at 4.57 seconds, 318 miles an hour. So unlike Atlanta, where he went out in the first round, he's moving on into second round competition.
Watch TJ on the left of your screen. Rise of clutch comes in, that front end starts coming up. He did a good job to get out of the throttle, keeping it from getting any higher and causing one of those infamous blowovers.
Well, let's bring in Bill Stevens.
All right, let's talk a little bit about what we saw in Funny Car this weekend. The big speeds, just incredible, as Gary Selzy and Tony Pedregon rewrote the record books. But don't lose sight of the fact that five other drivers in the qualified field went over 320 miles an hour in qualifying. And with the track conditions today, other guys could be putting up some big numbers. Dave?
Bill, when will the team Kalina Cars start winning? They've been awesome on Saturday, grabbing six of the eight races' number one qualifying spots, led by David Grubnik, the R&D driver, with four. But on Sunday, 0-2 in the finals. Doug Kalina, the only member of that three-car team to make it that far. But three of the top four spots belong to team Kalina today, so they have their next best chance to change their luck. Parker Johnstone.
Dave, there's good news for the pro stock field this weekend. For the second event in a row, Greg Anderson is not the number one qualifier. But there's bad news. The number one qualifier, well, it's his teammate and employee, rookie Jason Lyne. Now number one qualifier, looking for his first race win in this young career, Marty.
All right. Thanks, guys. Those are just some of the stories that we'll be following throughout today's 3 hours of coverage here at Route 66. Now, there was a lane change. Darrell Russell had the lane choice, originally headed for the right lane, and has switched back over to the left side. So, obviously, Wayne DePuis saw something in that first run that he didn't like.
Well, you know, I think the lanes are pretty even if you could keep it in the groove. The problem with this racetrack, especially since they've redone it down track, is it's got a very narrow groove, and the drivers are really have to be on top of their game to keep it in there. We saw, you know, TJ Zizzo basically wheels it, and the car went out of the groove off to the side, and obviously had to shut off. We've seen Corey Mack do the same thing in qualifying yesterday, so that looks like it might be a characteristic of that right lane. So I think as a result, he switched.
Bill?
And Mike, I think the fact that the top fuel guys didn't get four runs on the racetrack this weekend may have played into Wayne's decision. Knowing that he didn't get down that lane as many times as he would have liked, he probably watched that first round and saw something, adding to the fact that he didn't have enough shots at the track that made him want to switch.
Good point, Bill, because Top Fuel only had two qualifying sessions. The other classes had three. You're looking at Darrell Russell, who has qualified for every race since he came on tour, 78 straight, but he's winless in his last 33. And there's the man who's gone to three straight finals in a row, Clay Milliken. Well, there won't be four straight in a row because Darrell Russell, 4.55 seconds, 315 miles an hour, and he is in to second round competition for the second event in a row. We've got to take a commercial break. More first round Top Fuel when we return. And we will now get a chance to see Corey McLenathan come up against his old teammate from a couple of years ago, David Baca. As there is Corey Mack over in the left lane. And take a look at the graph when you see the names, Kenny and Brandon and Tony Schumacher, and there's Corey finally in there. How big a win was this, not only for Corey Mack, but for all of Top Fuel?
Well, it was huge for Corey Mack and that team. I mean, it's a new team. He brought some new people on board, Todd Smith and some other people, and they really seemed to gel. And Corey really believes in this team, and I think it was just a great win for all of them.
Number five on the all-time Top Fuel win list behind Joe Amato, Kenny Bernstein, Big Daddy Don Garlitz, and Larry Dixon. Parker?
Marty, I checked in with Darrell Russell's crew chief Wayne DePuis as to why he made that last-minute lane change. He said it was the start line. He liked the look of the left lane, thought there was a little bit more grip, a little bit more traction, and that's why he made the change.
That's why he gets paid the bucks. Here we go with Corey Mack and David Baca. Goes low for the round. 4.51 seconds, 324 miles an hour. And poor David Baca, he goes 4.54 and loses the race.
Well, I tell you, this was a great pass. This was just like, Corey was on a run just like this yesterday when he was in the opposite lane and carried the front end just like TJ Zizzo and got over towards the wall and had to shut off. They came back pretty much, left the same setup on and said, let's try to keep this thing stuck on the front end on the ground, even though it's lifting pretty good right there. Corey was still able to drive the thing, keep it in the middle of the group, and continue through the run and made a great pass.
Look at the concentration in Larry Dixon right now. He knows what's at stake. This team is in eighth place in the points, 263 behind coming into today's action. He's up against a guy who has beaten him three out of four times that they have hooked up, Doug Coletta. And Coletta can't afford to lose this round because Tony Schumacher has already won. If he wants to keep pace in the points championship, he's got to put Dixon on the trailer. There is Don the Snake Prudhomme. This is one of those titanic struggles. Talked about the problems that this team has faced, Larry Dixon's squad, yesterday during the qualifying shows. And the biggest comment that came from Don Prudhomme in front of everybody, I mean, absolutely everybody is a key player on that team. He says, this team is as tight as ever. And they said, yeah, when somebody does something wrong, they get chewed out. But they got chewed out when the times were good. And right now, they are looking on getting back on track. Let's go to Bill. He's with Corey Mack.
Corey Mack did the yummy dance getting out of the car. You just smoked your old teammate, went low for the round with a 4.51.
Gotta love that, don't you? Todd, the guy did a great job. It was on a good run yesterday, but I had to shut it off to have the fun in the air. But what a way to come back. That's awesome. You know, Dave, those guys are a great team. Johnny West, awesome guy. But for our team, that's the way to do it.
Thanks, Bill. Doug Coletta, the first of three Coletta cars. Think about this. You have three race cars. You've had seven races. That's 21 chances to win so far. Only Doug's been to a final this year.
You know, their problem has been consistency. We talk about it all the time. They get into that tire smoke problem, but, you know, they make a lot of horsepower. If they get hooked up, they can run the big number. Larry Dixon, on the other hand, I mean, I know why Snake believes in that team. I mean, they're, you know, you can't count that man right there. Dick LaHaye, Larry Dixon, they didn't win a whole lot of races because they were lucky. I mean, they know what they're doing. It's just one of those things. They're just getting a handle on this. They've got a ways to go, but hopefully he can nail a number right now.
.48 seconds later, at 331 miles an hour, Doug Coletta puts Larry Dixon on the trailer again. Dave Reif.
Even Don the Snake Prudhomme has a little bit of a grin. That was a pretty tough competitor in that other lane. He threw up a good number.
Yeah, 48. I mean, that's pretty awesome. That 56 we ran, thought was just great. But, you know, that's things are getting pretty tough out here in drag racing these days.
So let's take another look at Larry Dixon. As the first time in 5 years, back to 1999, he has lost three first-round matchups in a row.
But boy, look at him carrying the front end, trying to keep that thing in the middle of the groove. You saw him turn that wheel to the left as it was up in the air, making sure he didn't get to the right side and causing some excessive tire spin. But still a good run for Larry Dixon, but unfortunately, he came up short.
Yeah, he and David Baca are going to be able to commiserate. They both run 50s, and they lose. Bill.
Well, an amazing statistic. The last 2 years at this race, Larry Dixon has been in the 450s in six out of the eight rounds that he's competed. But I'm telling you, a 450 is never going to beat a 448. You got three more of those in this car today?
I tell you, I sure hope so. You know, this Mac Tillis team is definitely looking forward to a good day. This is a great facility. You know, I got Connie and Jim O and Ron Tober behind this thing, so it's just great.
Boy, what a blast.
You know, we were just checking back at Pomona. They had a similar race. Larry ran a 4.59. Guess what Doug ran? A 4.48. That was second round when he put him on the trailer for the first time this year. Coming up now with Brandon Bernstein and Bob Vandergrift. And we have gotten a report that doctors had to be called in for Brandon, and he is suffering from some kind of virus, some kind of flu. And we're going to be interested to see how it is going to affect him in the car. There is Kenny Bernstein. They'll be over in the left lane.
big thing when you have the flu is you got to worry about dehydration. And luckily, it's not real warm out today, but still, inside that car, even though they're only in there for a couple minutes, it still can affect you.
Yeah, I mean, if this was Indy or at Daytona, a NASCAR event, people would really understand this. But, you know, it's hard for them to understand how much stress and how much fluid intake you still have to do when you're driving this machine, and you know about it.
Yeah, one of the things, I mean, when you do get dehydrated, you start losing focus, and that's the main thing you want to be when you in one of these cars. You want to be focused.
Parker?
I checked in with Brandon earlier. He had his head on the table in the hospitality area. He did not feel well at all. You mentioned hydration. The other place where that plays a role is in reaction time. The more dehydrated you are, the slower you are.
Well, Bob Vandergriff was first off the line, but boy, when you get a 447 tune-up from Tim Richards at 333.41 miles an hour, which is a career best ET for Brandon. Back here at round eight of the NHRA Powerade Drag Racing Series, it's time for semifinals of Top Fuel, and you're looking at Scott Wise. And let's show you that he has the lane choice in our Top Fuel ladder, presented by Lucas Oil, over Doug Coletta. And in the other matchup, it'll be number one and number two in the points. Number one's got the lane choice, Tony Schumacher over B-squared. Back out on the track, there is Doug's elapsed times, and he really dodged a bullet in that last round when Corey Mack went red.
Yeah, because he definitely had the thing way over center. They smoked the tires very early in the run, but fortunately for him that Corey did red light. Scott Wise had lane choice, took the right lane. That was the lane he was in the previous round when he didn't have lane choice. Most of the teams have been choosing the left-hand lane, but I'll tell you what, if you keep it in the middle of the groove, there's no difference in the lane.
And the win light to Doug Coletta. He drives around him because Scott had a bunch on him at the start. 4.46 seconds, 332 miles an hour. That's low elapsed time of the race. Wow.
Boy, Doug Coletta almost ran a 4.46 and got beat on a hole shot. Scott Wise did a great job. There's a margin of victory right there, 13 thousandths of a second. Boy, that was close.
Parker, where are you?
Well, Marty, I'm on top of the grandstands on the south side of the racetrack. That's to driver's right. The wind has been howling 25 miles an hour and more all day long. How these grandstands affect the drivers and the riders? Well, it's significant. The first half of the track is sheltered, but when they clear the edge of this grandstands, bang, they get hit by a big blast of wind. The fans that are up here with me, they say as soon as Tony Pettergon, in that last run, cleared these grandstands, he started moving left, and in fact, as we saw, got shoved all the way across the center line. Has a great effect on the drivers. John Force told me, as he clears the grandstands, Marty, he's already turning to the right to compensate for it.
Well, as we can see by some of the spectators, it is quite brisk out there as we get ready now for Brandon Bernstein and Tony Schumacher. You've been in that situation. What's it like?
Well, a couple things have to happen. I mean, one, you have to have a very tight racetrack. What happens is, you notice on some of the replays, the front end's very light. Well, you get a light front end where it's a little bit hard to steer down track and then get that crosswind, boy, the driver's going to definitely have their hands full.
There you see the numbers that Brandon has to run to set a new national record in speed. Remember, no bonus points for speed, so they're not going to be worried about that. They want the points that go with beating Tony Schumacher. Let's quickly go to the far end.
Actually, the wind is from the backwash on Doug Coletta's car, a 4.46.
That's beautiful. I tell you, you know, this Mack Tools car, you know, redlined with us. I just can't say enough about, you know, the effort we got going on here with Ron Tober and Connie. And, you know, we got by that when it wasn't pretty. You know, as far as the car went, I think I left a little desired on the start, but we'll get him on the next one.
Better. A little slow, but he made up for it when that thing hooked up.
The horsepower saved is bacon, that's for sure. Here we go. Oh, the points championship has just narrowed. And Brandon Bernstein has backed up that new speed record. He goes 332 miles an hour, and he goes 4.46 with a 2, and he's got lane choice by 3/1000th, a new career best elapsed time. And there is Kenny Bernstein and Dave Reif. It's all yours.
The king of speed. Your son is now the king of speed.
Yeah, he just got under me, didn't he? Oh, that's cool. Great. Great job by the Budweiser Lucas team. Can't say enough about it. That team over there is tough. Let me tell you, you come up there, you better have everything together, and they did a great great job on both sides.
Not only quicker, but faster. He's got the speed record.
He gets me too, both ways.
Yeah. There'll be some ribbon at the dinner table tonight. And the points margin has been cut to 43. Schumacher's lead over Bernstein. And the lane choice will be B squared in the final against Doug Kalita. All right, back here at Route 66, it is the NHRA Power Drag Racing Series, and we're getting ready for the teammates, Eric Medlin and John Force. First time these two have ever met in competition. Medlin's got the lane choice. He'll be on the left lane, and then it'll be Whit Basemore and Tony Bartone. And it's interesting, Bartone and Medlin both looking to go to their first finals. Of course, Basemore looking to go to his 40th. And John, well, how about number 171 in his career? Let's get more on this matchup. Dave Reif.
Well, Marty, earlier we heard Tony Pedregon talk about hoping John Force would play from a level playing field when racing Eric Medlin. I talked to both the drivers. That is indeed the case. Eric will go out and try to duplicate his mid-470 pass. John, no tuning data from the previous round. Austin Coyle will make a best guess. But, guys, I want to bring up something that just happened. Storyline we identified a few races ago. Eric Medlin and the burnout did not do a very good burnout at all.
All right, Mikey, we're on board with him.
Well, that's what happened. He didn't smoke the tires, and generally that builds a little extra heat in the clutch when you do that, and that could definitely be a problem. And if he smokes the tires, we're going to have all the conspiracy theorists on that, but that can definitely contribute by not doing a good burnout to a tire smoke situation. We'll see what happens.
Well, Tony Pedregon raised the specter. We'll find out in a matter of seconds. Well, John goes 4.72, 329 miles an hour. And take another look as we go on board.
Man, I don't know what happened here. I mean, it looked like he just kind of rolled off the light and tried to ease into the throttle, whacked it a couple times, and just said, "Here you go, John. You're in the final."
Well, that ET ties his national record that he set just last year. So, is this by the burnout? I mean, he was laid off the line. It looked like a bucket Bronco, and I'm sure the conspiracy theorists will be on this one. Well, there is the far end. Let's go to Bill.
With Brandon Bernstein, I just can't help but remember in 2001, you had the double up victory with your dad here in the fall. 3 years later, a career best elapsed time and a national speed record.
Well, I can't say enough about this Budweiser Lucas Oil team and Tim and Kim and those guys. I mean, this is their baby, and it's fun to drive when they go that fast, though. I mean, finish line comes so fast, it's just awesome. I mean, it's just such a rush, man. I just can't wait for the final.
And when was the last time we had two top fuel cars in the final round with identical 446s in the semis?
I think the answer to that one would be zero. We've had them quicker, but I don't think we've had identicals. All right, it's time for Whit Basemore and Tony Bartone to come to the line. And as we mentioned, Bartone trying to get to his first ever final. And, boy, you're going to have to run a national record-type number to get lane choice in this one. As the backup continues, let's go to the far end.
John Force and teammate Eric Medlin are down here. John, by now you know the numbers. What a spectacular run.
Well, it's been there all week, and John Medlin and Jimmy Prock have been showing us with Denton's car and Eric's car, and I saw Eric had a problem on the burnout. It jumped up on the tires. It didn't smoke too much. And my old heat, she just trucked down through there, so, hey, we'll take it. But we both moved up in the points. See if we can pull this off in the final for Castle, Ford, Max, Ripley, and these guys. We ain't done much lately. Don't forget.
Hey, let me jump in here. What happened to you at the start?
No, it had the whole clutch the whole time. The same thing happened to Denton at Gainesville, I believe it was, or somewhere. But I thought, man, am I that stupid on the burnout? Then I would let the clutch out to back up, and it was in my lap. So, and I knew we were messed up. But I tried my best. It's starting line. You can't just hit it when it's like that because it's got too much. So I tried easing into it, and I was telling my dad, a little bit too big of a bull today.
Well, when he says the clutch was back in his lap, that means like all the levers were in, and he knew it was, if he hit get full throttle, he was going to smoke the tires.
Well, guess what? 4.71! Holy smokes! 333 miles an hour. That will be a new national record elapsed time.
will check it to make sure that he has backed it up. He has. And a new speed record, 333 miles an hour. Beard owns them both, and so does Whit Mazemore.
Lee Beard turned the knobs, 333 miles an hour. Unbelievable,
Lee. Just a fantastic facility here in Chicago. Wished every racetrack was like this. And we can really pour the coals to it here, Parker.
Well, I knew he was fired up. He didn't want to take Gary Selzy's record lightly. He wanted one for his own.
He wanted lane choice for the final.
Yeah, well, he got lane choice for the final. And look at those numbers. And remember, there's 20 bonus points. If he still holds onto that record at the end of this event, that's 20 more points. That would help make up for those 25 he lost in the oil down penalties just a few races ago.
Back at Route 66 Raceway in Joliet, Illinois, we just saw an explosive semifinal in Funny Car. I am with Bazemore. Friday night, you saw your teammate, the first to 3:30. You saw Tony Pedregon go quicker than anybody, and you just made fast work of both of them.
Well, I tell you what, it's Beard, you know. It's a credit to the entire Mecco Tools team, and actually Zippy and Selzy's Oakley Dodge team as well. You know, they may have shown us how to do a little speed, and then yesterday I think Zippy was checking out Beard's computer to see how to do some ET. But we're here just to win rounds, and it's great to see Bartone and that Dunn car start to have their luck turn a little bit. You guys ran well, and you know, we're not too excited yet. We've got to beat Force in the final. That's going to be tough.
He has established a new elapsed time record worth 20 points, which has helped him to take the points lead.
All right, let's take a look at Pro Stock and our ladder presented by Lucas Oil. Jason Lyne will have lane choice over Dave Conley in one semifinal, and it'll be Greg Anderson against his old teacher and boss, Warren Johnson. And we come to the line with Dave Conley and Jason Lyne already getting ready to pre-stage. Two of the new young stars of Pro Stock. Jason, a rookie at 34, but Conley only 21 years of age. Oh, and look at Conley cutting another great light. But Jason has the horsepower. 6.79 seconds, 202 miles an hour. That is low elapsed time of the race for Pro Stock. And Jason is going to the finals again.
Just a nice run by Jason Lyne. I mean, he was second off the line, but an 0.23 reaction time. That's 23 thousandths from perfect. Not a bad light. And then you couple that with a 6.79. That's a good pass.
All right, as Greg Anderson gets ready, he knows that his team car will be in the final. Now it's up to Warren Johnson to deny Greg a chance to meet up with him. And as we check the record books, there you see Greg is now up to 28-1. And he is continuing his march towards the history books. As he backs up, let's go to the far end with Bill.
Here's Jason Lyne, just about ready to get out his ride, and I'll be waiting right here with good news for him. Low ET of the race, 6.79, Jason, in another final round.
Can't be mad at that.
He's referring to you being the number one qualifier this weekend.
Cool. It's been an awesome weekend so far. We just need Greg to get in the final, and we'll have a good race for the end.
Like everything else with this team, we won't have to wait long to find out.
Greg trying to go to his sixth straight final. Of course, for Warren Johnson, we documented his problems earlier. There's Kurt Johnson. He's hoping that, you know, Dad can do something because Kurt's losing ground in the points championship. KJ second in the points right now by 269. And it's 20 points per round. That gives you an idea of the domination of Greg Anderson. Time this year, it is going to be an all Ken Black final, as this team is just really unstoppable. 6.82 on the clock, 201 miles an hour for Greg, and he is one lap away from history as he will try and win his sixth straight race. Nobody's ever done that in one single season. The all-time record is 9 over 2 years, and guess who holds that? Bob Glidden. And well, Jason Lyne's going to have the lane choice over the boss. And there is Jason waiting for him as we're getting ready for Pro Stock Bike. And down on the starting line, we're already getting set for Sean Gann and Michael Phillips. We're guaranteed of having a new Pro Stock Bike winner at this particular event because everybody else that's won here before is gone. It's Andrew Hines with lane choice in one of the semifinals. And it is Michael Phillips in the other. Talk about Michael Phillips with a slight advantage over Gann. And the win like the Sean, though. Boy, he came and drove around him. They run identical 727s, 184 miles an hour, the winning speed for Sean Gann as Gann moves into the finals.
Look at that, 15 ten-thousandth of a second difference. That's pretty close.
And just that quickly, we are getting ready for the next pair, which will be Andrew Hines and Craig Treble. Parker, you've got more?
Yes, Marty, as I talked about earlier, that crosswind, a big concern for these riders. To compensate, they changed the alignment of that big rear tire. Craig Treble told me they went too far with that adjustment on the last run, and he nearly made a right-hand turn at the hit of the throttle. So hopefully they've got that worked out.
All right, Craig Treble has liked getting back on this old Suzuki. It's a 98 version that he borrowed last year. I think now he's bought the thing, and he is having great success with this machine. I mean, he's tried several different chassis in the interim. And here we go. Couple of 009 light and a 709 elapsed time. That is a track record, and it is certainly low for the race. And you can't wonder why Andrew had so much air to spare winning this one.
Doesn't get much better than that. What a 009 reaction time and then a 709 elapsed time, and you're going to win the majority of your races. Look at this. Hanging on here, Andrew Hines. Not much wrong with this ride. Straight down the middle of the parkway into the final round.
And there you see the matchups for the final. Andrew Hines will have the lane choice as Sean Gann has now moved into third place in the points. Bill?
Well, Sean Gann is carrying the hopes of Suzuki fans all over the world into this final round, but a 727 to what you just saw Andrew do. You going to have enough?
Man, I don't know about that. We're just trying to collect rounds, and you know, if they finish 1 and 2 in the championship, their team put together a monster, and they come out here and it's showing. So that's what Mac Tools has got to try and wrench up for me.
Pretty much the opinion of all the Suzuki riders. 7:09, Andrew. You just hammered everybody.
Man, that pass was, it actually wasn't the best. I kind of went left, went right. I just went down the track, and I knew my brother's bike was in the other lane with Craig Treble riding it, and I just wanted to do everything I could to win. I guess I had a 009 light, ran an 09 track record. This bike's just getting faster and faster by the ride, and we'll see what we have for the final.
I hope Sean Gann didn't hear that.
Yeah, that is the Suzuki that Matt Hines used to ride, and he sold it now to Craig Treble. Finals when we come back. All right, let's get you caught up if you have just tuned in because you have missed a record-setting day. Here is Whit Bazemore, closest to you in funny car. Second time in his career, he's held the national ET record, 4.713 seconds. He went 333 miles an hour. He could back that up for a new speed mark in the final. He's got to go 329 and some high change. In Top Fuel, Brandon Bernstein, the new king of speed. He goes 333.41 miles an hour and backed it up on this run, 332, and now he is quicker and faster than Father Kenny. And we also want to give you our Kestrel startup of the day. That's the best reaction times, and in Pro Stock Bike, you can't get any better than Michael Phillips with his second career perfect light. Dave Conley in Pro Stock, 006. Bob Vandergriff at 033, which is very good in Top Fuel. And Whit Bazemore, 070, as we're ready for Sean Gann right there in the left lane against Andrew Hines. And this is the Pro Stock Bike Final. There is Sean's road to the final. He's trying to become the first Suzuki rider to win that isn't female, because the other two have been Karen Stouffer and Angel Savoie. The other race went to the guy in the right lane. And he's on the V-Rod, the Harley, and Andrew Hines looking for his second career win. Oh, and Andrew goes red. Oh, and then throws away a 717. And Sean Gann 7.24 seconds, 185 miles an hour, picks up his third career win as he was in the finals last week and got beat by Angel. This week he comes back to take the win.
Wow, that's a pretty big upset. I mean, when you got a bike that just ran 7.09 the previous round, I don't know if I would be up there trying to cut the tree that close, but Andrew Hines did, unfortunately for him. He missed on it and gave that man right there, Sean Gann, the win. Great job.
Well, and it's going to give Sean Gann a jump because he moves ahead of GT Tonglet into second place in the points. And you can hear him underneath the helmet as he is loving it, as he has won for the first time in a year. Let's go to Bill.
Man, I am paralyzed with shock. He fouls out and you win the race. Nobody thought you could.
You get it. You know what I'm saying? Go to church. God will give it to you if you pray for it. Mac Tools, Airtech, Worldwide Bearing, Technicoat Companies. Man, they all helped me so much. And my dad is getting ready to come down here and we're getting ready to get a fat steak. And I'm taking Andrew out with me.
Let's go to Dave.
Andrew, 035 red, pressing it a little too much.
Man, I don't know what happened out there. Just the trees real fast today. I think I actually red lit against Antron too, but his light was worse. I just had a 009 against Craig, and man, these lights are quick out here. I don't know what I ran. I just started short shifting because I saw Gann's red light on. But congrats to him. They got a good team over there, but we're going to come back and
all right, as we turn our focus to another page of potential history, no pro stock driver has ever won six straight races in a single season. The legendary Bob Glidden did nine in a row over 2 years, but five has been the most. Parker?
Marty, Greg Anderson was late coming to the start line as he was getting his helmet and gloves on. Crewman putting the dashboard in. He spent every moment of that turnaround working on his Pontiac Grand Am because they've got a problem they can't identify. It's got the best of all the parts, but the car is getting slower and slower. He told me he was nearly ready to concede this run to Jason Lyon, but not yet.
And there is Jason's road to the final. And you look at the performance, and Jason has had the better of it today. In the elapsed time numbers, there is Greg's now updated round record as he is 29-1. And if he can get past his teammate, as you look at the best elapsed times, it will be six wins in a row. Unbelievable. Here we go.
And Anderson gives it away.
A 6.82 to a 6.84. So Greg gives away the better elapsed time. Look at Jason's reaction time, 004. But wow. Line, the first new pro stock car winner in this class since Troy Coughlin at Maple Grove in 2001.
Wow, big surprise here. Greg Anderson might have thrown him off having all those problems coming up the starting line. Maybe not quite as focused. He knew he was going to have to get a good light against Jason because, like you said, Marty, Jason had the better car. But I'll tell you what, he just pushed the tree a little bit too much, and Jason Lyon gets his first win. Good job.
And we're going to send it to Bill.
My head is spinning around. Two final rounds, two red lights, two favorites losing to guys who we felt had no shot whatsoever. Jason Lyon about to get out of the car. Jason, did you know that Greg fouled out?
I saw it.
And what was the problem he was having with his car? Do you think that affected him at all?
I don't know. I think he probably felt a little under the gun because this car was running faster all weekend. So that run didn't feel very good to me, though. How fast was it?
You really don't want to know. You just won your first national event in pro stock.
I do want to know, actually.
684.
84? That's, that didn't feel quite right.
Spoken like a true mechanic.
All right, take a look. It's 289 markers back to Kurt, and Jason is closing in on KJ for second place in the points championship. Dave Reeve.
Craig Anderson. Oops.
That was a screw up there. That absolutely looked like a rookie screw up, you know? Sometimes when you race your buddies, you get a little too excited, and I absolutely got too excited, and I double-clutched it. It was time to go, and it wasn't time to go, and give him the race. It would have been a great race. I'm sorry. I screwed up, but you know what? He's earned it today. He's run great all weekend, and I'm just very proud of him. I screwed up, but the bottom line is he may have whipped my butt anyway. I don't know. But he didn't screw up. I did. He won the race.
Competition's been waiting for that, but unfortunately, it was his teammate he screwed up against.
And as we come back to the starting line, here is Whit Bazemore's road to the final. This will be the ninth time that he and John Force have met in finals. John has won six of the prior eight meetings. And remember, Witt has just set the new elapsed time record, taking it away from John. Parker?
Marty, there is a lot of pride on the line. Lee Beer told me he was tired of Witt's teammate Gary Selzy getting the attention for being the first over 330. Tony Pendragon getting the attention for going 331. And of course, the man in the other lane, John Force. Well, nothing gets this team revved up more than that car. Witt's concern is, he said, John every once in a while can cut a great light. And Witt's afraid that today might be the day, so he's on edge as well.
Well, we'll find out. Watch how deep they try and stage the cars, because I have a feeling John's going to take a bite.
Yeah, he usually does. In the final round of Bristol, he took a little bit of a shot at the tree, got a great reaction time. We'll see what happens this time.
Oh, Bits and Brits in trouble. And Force has done it again. 4.75 seconds, 325 miles an hour. So John gets the win, Witt gets the record, and wow, did they pulled one out of the hat today, Parker.
They really did. We are all going with you, Austin Coyle, to the casinos immediately after this.
I don't blame you one bit. We for sure cashed in some luck chips here. I mean, that second round we come up here, the motor was dead. It had a problem, and we just figured we'd fake it, and we were fortunate enough to get a free gift. And then after that, the old heap run pretty good, and here we are.
They broke those floodgates down at Bristol, and now the winds are coming, Marty.
Look at John getting out, and he has moved into second place in the points championship. In fact, let's show you, it's 16 markers. Witt picks up that extra 20. That's the difference right now for setting the new national elapsed time record. Dale Worsham's been bumped down to third.
Well, watch the old heap in the right-hand lane. Not too much wrong with that. 475 right down the track. I'm sure Lee Beard was probably trying to run the same thing he ran the previous run, but unfortunately, that thing spun the tires very early, and all Witt could do was watch John Force take away the win.
There he is. Let's go to Bill.
God say anything to you before that round?
Yeah, I said, don't be stupid up here and do something stupid. Bay's got the record, both ends, congratulations to him. But bottom line, we came up, we did, and that was to win Chicago. This one's for my boys, Austin Coyle, his wife at home, and all the ones that have been rooting for us. Lisa supports him a lot, and it's great, and he's been under a lot of pressure, and I was very proud of him and Brandy today. But we worked as a team. She came out here for Castro Ford, Max. She done what she did. I don't know what kind of numbers she run. Roof hatch opened just like that. Right when I was staging, the roof hatch went open, I thought, don't break the focus here. The old heap, she just trucked right down through there. So for MBNA and everybody bumper to bumper, I'm excited. And really, that's just the bottom line.
I think he just took his hat off to Austin Coyle.
Austin Coyle.
Thanks, as we get ready now for the last race of the day.
And
I got to be honest with you, I didn't think we'd get this race in with the way the weather was playing havoc with us, but here we go with Doug Coletta and Brandon Bernstein. Bernstein is 5 for 5 in finals. There he is with his new national record top speed at 333. Parker.
Brandon Bernstein, remember, had the flu, did not look good at the beginning of the day. Adrenaline helped pick him up. I just checked in with him. He is not feeling well at all, Marty.
Been beaten for the first time in a final. And look at Doug Coletta, 4.420, 328 miles an hour. And Doug Coletta not only wins the race, he does it in style, as he doesn't have quite enough to back up a national record. But watch what happens to Brandon.
Man, Brandon Bernstein, they were going for it. Watch the front end come up here. It's high, high, no wheelie bar. Oops, I better get out of it. He got out of it just in time. But I'll tell you what can you say about Doug Coletta? 442, he's running 283 miles per hour at the half track. That tells you what kind of horsepower and what kind of track they were on this weekend.
Here are the new points as Brandon Bernstein only 43 behind Tony Schumacher, but Doug Coletta has closed to within just 5 rounds of racing. We can tell you the 442 is just a touch shy of having a national ET record. Bill?
Right. We just saw the quickest elapsed time in Top Fuel history, 442.0, and you win the race, Doug Coletta.
I tell you what, hands off to this whole Mack Tools team, Connie and Ron and you know, everybody's worked real hard to get this thing where we're at today. So just hats off to them. And, you know, the car, he got right to the finish line and threw the bell off, and I thought he was going to go around me. But, you know, everybody at Red Line and Champion and, you know, Technico guys, Fisher Honda, appreciate the support.
Let's go to Dave Reif.
Down with a disappointed Whit Bazemore, who does have 20 extra points for the national record. Also leads the points, just missing that trophy.
Yeah, and honestly, that trophy is the only reason we came here. You know, the better the team is, the better your results, the better you are, the more expectations you have, obviously, and the harder it is. And that's why, you know, when you see a John Force, you have to respect him, because even though they've made it look easy a lot of times, it isn't. It's never easy, and it's tough. And the better you are, the harder it is to live up to your own expectations.
Game's on.
And the championship chase is far from over. Now let's go back to Top Fuel one more time. Take a look at Brandon. Remember, no wheelie bar. If he keeps pressing it, and the 25-mile-an-hour crosswind, he could have easily had a blow over here.
Still a lot of things for Brandon Bernstein to learn, and I think you just learned about how high a Top Fuel car can go without going over.
Yeah, you betcha. This Budweiser Lucas Oil car, you know, left so hard, had the front end up a little bit, and then it laid it back down, and then it seemed like about half track when the clutch came in and everything. Man, it just picked the front end up, and it was going. I mean, if I would have stayed in it, it definitely would have blown over. So, you know, hey, I can't say enough about the team. The team did a great job this weekend. Tim and Kim, all the guys, they worked their butts off, and it's hot and humid out here, and it's just tough. But, you know, hey, we gained a little bit of points, and we'll go to the next one.
And you see our schedule for next week, qualifying on Saturday, and then our final eliminations at 4 Eastern. For Mike Dunn, Bill Stevens, Dave Reed, Parker Johnson, and our entire ESPN2 crew, I'm Marty Reed. World Series of Poker's coming up next. We'll see you next time on NHRA Powerade Drag Racing. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader.